Going to do one verse. I didn't know we were going to do 60. Hey, welcome to Twickenham. If you're a guest this morning, thanks for coming out. I hope I hope it's immediately obvious that you do not have to be perfect to come here, okay? It should be patently obvious as soon as we begin. Glad you're here. Thanks for coming out to be with us. There is a card on the seat right in front of you. If you want to fill that out, you can do that and place it in the collection plate later in our service. If you're a guest, we would ask you to do that. So we'd like to send you a note to say thank you. And if you can have any prayer requests, you can also indicate that on that card. Sometimes folks want us to pray, just kind of want us to be private about it. You can indicate that. Or if you want the whole church praying about it, you can indicate that as well. Hey, balcony, how y'all doing up there? Everybody good? I haven't given you a shout out in a while, so here we go. If you are a Cubs fan, got any Cubs fans in the room? You guys have got to be happy right now. Got to be happy, because that's like the first time since the Ark landed on Mount Ararat, I think. There we go. All right. Although, if you're a Penn State fan, okay, you got to be happy about that, about yesterday. Crimson Tide, they did really well, right? War Eagle, they did great. Georgia did not lose yesterday. Okay, now here's the thing. This is connected. We could have gotten into all the high schools too. I know that Madison Academy won the other night, but here's the thing. Isn't it kind of funny how our spirits go up or down? How we're either happy or sad depending on the circumstances with our team. You know what? I have a funny feeling. I think it's that way with life, not just with our football and baseball teams. I think it's that way with life. If things are going awesome, we are up. And if life is not going well, we are down. But you know, joy, the way the Bible describes it, is not circumstantial. It just is. So we've got to figure out how to get from how we normally live to where God wants us to go. So we're going to need His guidance to do that. We need the Lord to guide us into a better way of thinking and feeling and living. So let's stand together this morning. We're going to sing this month. I think Guide Me, O is our next song, right? We're going to ask the Lord to guide us into a better place to be. Hey, we're glad you're here. Thanks for coming out. Let's see where the Lord's going to take us this morning. Let's sing.
Come thou fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me ever to adore thee, may I still thy goodness prove. While the hope of endless glory fills my heart with joy and love. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Never let me wander from thee. Never worship Jesus. God and Father, loving us like no other. Hear our prayer, the cry of our hearts, as we come to you. We acknowledge our transgressions. We confess to you our sins. Show us mercy and compassion. Touch our lives with your healing grace again. Release us from the past as we seek your face. Wash us free at last. We receive your love. We receive your healing grace. We receive your love. We receive your healing grace.
Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character. And character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us.
You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation.
As I think on the cross and the price that was paid, royal blood that was spilled, so the dying could live.
Every sin and disease, broken hearts come to you. I'm so grateful as your mercy and your grace cover me. Oh, the blood. Oh, the blood of Jesus, hallelujah, hallelujah, you're the reason I'm free. Oh, the praises, oh, the honor to the only Lord and Savior, hallelujah, hallelujah, you're the reason. My hands and my heart, I surrender again. Oh, devotion, adoration, with my life I will praise. Oh, the blood of Jesus, oh, the blood of Jesus, hallelujah, hallelujah, you're the reason I'm free. Oh, the praises, oh, the honor to the only Lord and Savior. Hallelujah, hallelujah, you're the reason I'm free.
And I run to Him who takes all the sin of the world. Hallelujah. And I run to Him who takes all the sin.
Let's bow together in prayer as we partake of the Lord's Supper. Our Father in heaven, we give praise to your name. Father, we praise you because of your awesome love. And Father, your love is poured out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit as we think about how you loved us despite our sins, that when we were weak and without strength, Christ died for the ungodly. And Father, we thank you that you loved us so much that when we were ungodly, you loved us and sent Jesus to the cross. And Father, help us to stand in awe of your tremendous love that when we were sinners, Christ died for us. And Father, we pray that every day we would have confidence that we're righteous and we're holy in your eyes because of his blood. And we thank you, Father, that Jesus went to the cross to pay the full penalty for our sins. We praise you, Father, because we can be here this morning and we're your sons and daughters in Christ because he turned away your anger at our sins when he went to the cross for us. Father, we pray that you would bless us as we meditate on what Jesus accomplished for us at the cross and that every day we would be transformed, knowing that we are your children, and knowing that now you send us out to love others as Christ loved us at the cross. Bless us now as we meditate on his sacrifice. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Your grace abounds to me.
O Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on
Let's pray. Our Father, we pray that you would guide us now as we meditate on what Jesus did at the cross. Father, that we would know that our only confidence, our only righteousness is what Jesus provides for us when he took our sins upon himself and was crucified and then rose from the dead. Father, we're amazed that when we were sinners, when we were weak, when we were ungodly, you loved us and sent Jesus to that cross. And we pray, Father, that every day we would be transformed by that, that we would share your love with others, that we would be conformed to his death, Father, and walk in the victory that we have in Christ every day. Bless us now as we think about the cross. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my I am found, I am yours.
But you are strong, you are sure, you are life, you endure, you are good, always true, you are light, shining through, but you are more than enough, you are here, you are
talking a little bit about the survey that we did, and one of the things that we were weak in was sharing Christ with others, which is a thing that we're working on and we want to work on. But there's a good opportunity coming up here pretty soon for you to sort of help with that. And it's going to sound a little counterintuitive, but it has to do with Halloween. So on the 30th, which is Is that next Sunday? Next Sunday. We're going to have our annual trunk and treat. And I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, Jody, how could you connect sharing Christ with Halloween? I mean, the one is all about the Lord and the one is all about the devil, right? Can you remember ever having some really fun, positive experiences in a church setting? I mean, I can. I remember some of the coolest things I ever did as a kid happened in a church environment. I think if we give people, if we give kids a memory of something really fun and positive that happened to them in a church environment, I think that's evangelism. We're planting a seed. And down the road, 10 years from now, 20 years from now, 30 years from now, who knows? Maybe they become followers of Jesus Christ because somewhere along the way, they had a positive experience. That's one way to look at this. That's how I look at events like this. It's our opportunity to reach out to our community in a way that our community is open to and say, hey, can we just be a part of this with you? So that hopefully at some point we get to say, can I tell you about Jesus? Next Sunday night, we'll come here. Bring your kids, bring your kids' friends. If you don't have kids that age or grandkids that age, you know what we could really use is your car up here in this parking lot with the trunk open, decorated. Last year, Lisa and I did our car to look like a construction zone, which was not hard with that particular car, okay? Can I just say? So just and fill it up with candy and be nice to people. Some of you can do that naturally. Others of you will have to pray before you get here, all right? But we can do this. Next Sunday night, would you be a part of that? Read the section in the bulletin right here. If you have questions about it, give our office a call. That'd be a really neat way for you to get involved and do something positive for our community through our church. Okay, so I want us to start with a game. We're going to play a game together, you and I, and you have to participate. It's one of those games. It's called Would You Rather. Have you ever played this game before? Would You Rather? We do this whenever somebody on staff has a birthday. We will have lunch in, and then the birthday boy or girl has to play Would You Rather, and we find out things about each other when we do that. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to do four Would You Rathers, all right? And so I just want you to share, I want you to respond to the people around you. Kind of tell them which you would rather do. Would you rather do this or would you rather do that? You make the choice. Tell the people around you, let them tell you, and then I'm going to tell you what my choice would be. Okay, so we'll just kind of go from there. You ready? Right. All right, here's our first one. Would you rather meet your ancestors or your descendants? Meet the people who came before, meet the people after. So share that with each other for just a second here. Tell the people around you. Okay, all right. Good. All right, here's my thinking on this one. I know about some of my ancestors, and I really don't want to meet those people, okay? I'm gonna take a chance that my descendants are not mad at me for passing all the dysfunctions, and I want to ask them about the stock market. That's all, okay? So, okay. All right, let's do another one. Would you rather be able to talk to animals or speak any foreign language? Go. Okay, here we go. Here's my thinking on this one. You can learn. Okay, if you said, I would rather speak any foreign language, you are lazy. You can learn that. All right? I would say, I got questions. I want to ask a dog, what's this about? What is this about? So I would want to do that one. Okay, let's do another one. Would you rather spend 3 days alone in a dark room or 24 hours with your least favorite president of the United States candidate? Okay, just kind of share that. 3 days alone. Okay, here's mine. This is as close to politics as I'm going to get in preaching. I don't like either one of them, okay? So I'm kind of out of that one. I'm going to be 3 days alone. All right, one more. We're going to do one more here. Here's the last one. Would you rather spend 5 minutes in a tub full of non-venomous snakes? We're not done. Just wait. or a night in an abandoned hospital with a clown? Okay. You know, recently I told you how I feel about snakes, so let's go, Chuckles. We're going to the hospital. Okay. That's fun. Now, okay, based on the answers that the people around you gave, if you'd like to put some distance between you and them, you feel free to move about the cabin right now, okay? Don't answer these out loud. These next are not part of the game, but they're choices, okay? Would you rather be in prison facing a death sentence or have joy? Would you rather be hungry or have joy? Would you rather be experiencing anxiety or have joy? Would you rather be a part of a persecuted minority living in a culture that is hostile to what you believe or have joy? These last few are really trick questions. We're beginning this series today from the book of Philippians. The series is called Whatever. Joy, no matter what. The author, Paul, wrote this little letter from prison, and the outcome of his trial was uncertain, and a guilty verdict meant death. He also talked about times when he endured hunger, anxiety, tears, and persecution, and yet he could write something like this from Philippians chapter 1, verse 4. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy. Or he wrote this from Philippians chapter 2, verse 18. You too should be glad and rejoice with me. Or perhaps the most famous one of all from Philippians chapter 4, verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say it, rejoice. That's why we're calling this series Whatever. Joy no matter what. Paul was apparently able to experience joy despite some pretty unhappy circumstances. So there must be something qualitatively different between what Paul is talking about and what we usually define as joy. This morning, we're going to be laying a foundation for the next three lessons in this series. This morning is really foundational sort of stuff, and it's big picture kind of things that we need to get. So it's not going to be what you'd call an easy listening sermon. If you had fun the first 5 minutes, that's it. The rest of this will not be any fun, okay? You're going to have to do a little more work is what I'm saying. You okay with that? Let's go. For most people, joy is the emotion we feel when things are going well, when life is going well. If we have the basics covered, housing, health, food, transportation, friends, family, then we feel some joy. We've got a little bit of joy if we've got the basics covered. That way of thinking, then, it's pretty natural to go from that to saying, well, if I possess all of those things in increasing measure, if a few of those things bring me joy, then more of those things will bring me more joy. A better, bigger house, fancier, more abundant food, finer transportation, newer, nicer clothes, cooler friends, better health. Presumably all of that equals more joy. If a little bit of stuff brings a little bit of joy, then a lot of stuff brings a lot of joy, is the way we think. Except you have known people, or you know people, or maybe even you are someone who has all of the things you would think that would correlate with joy, and yet we don't have it. They don't have it. David Geffen said, anybody who thinks money will make you happy hasn't got money. Centuries before Benjamin Franklin said, "Money never made a man happy yet, nor will it. The more a man has, the more he wants. Instead of filling a vacuum, it makes one." Now, here's the even more crazy thing. Even more astounding is the fact that there are people who have very little of what you would think makes life go well, and yet inexplicably are possessed of great joy. Here's a question that's been bugging me all week. I hope it'll bug you. Is it possible that joy has less to do with how well life is going and more to do with living life well? Let me say that again. Is it possible that joy has less to do with how well life is going and more to do with living life well? Before we get too far into this conversation, I want to be sure I don't leave you feeling unnecessarily guilty if you're not feeling very joyful today. Some of us are in the middle of a hard time right now. Life is not going well at all. Maybe you're reeling from some family wreckage, or struggling with financial insecurity, or you're dealing with a personal loss. I know that two of our families this week are dealing with personal loss. Melody Cathy passed away late last week, and then early this morning, we've been praying for Janice Sanford for a long time. Sister Sanford passed away. So I know that some of us are feeling some of that. In fact, let's just do this. Let's take a second and let's pray for those families. Will you do that with me here real quick? God, there are a lot of folks in our church family right now that are struggling. We are struggling with some wreckage in our families that we don't really feel, we're embarrassed by it. And we don't know what to do. We're afraid to talk about it, but we don't feel very joyful because of that. And some of us are dealing with financial problems. God, some of us, like Melody's family and Sister Sanford's family, are struggling with their loss, and we pray for peace and comfort in those times, in this season of grief and loss. Would you bless those families? Would you help us to be there for them? In Jesus' name. Amen. So what I don't want to do is to load a pile of guilt on top of the stuff you're already feeling. So let's be sure we know what we're talking about when we talk about joy. When we talk about joy, no matter what, we're not talking about the kind of emotion you feel when you walk through the gates at Disney. That's fun. Fun and joy are not the same thing. Fun is more like a fix. In fact, you may have said this before, I need to get a fun fix. I need to go have some fun. Joy is a state. Fun is temporary. Joy abides. Fun is often expensive. Joy is free. Some of you can testify to this. I could testify to this. Fun can sometimes lead to unhappy consequences. This is the South. Okay? Hey, y'all, watch this. Joy never leaves a bad taste and never comes with a hangover. Fun and joy are not the same thing. We're not talking about, when we talk about joy, no matter what, we're not talking about the kind of emotion you feel when your team wins in the final seconds of the game. That's excitement. But excitement and joy are not the same. Like fun, excitement is circumstantial. It depends on what's happening to you. Joy is all about what's happening in you. Joy may be fun, but more often it's a feeling of peace when circumstances are turbulent. Joy may include excitement. More often it's a feeling of confident hope even when circumstances are troubling. In the Bible, especially in the New Testament, joy has a dynamically different feel than the way most people think it might. It is oblivious to circumstances. Let me just give you three passages that demonstrate that. Luke chapter 6, verses 22 and 23. These are the words of Jesus, okay? He said, Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. And then he said, rejoice in that day and leap for joy. Look, there's not another way to say this. If people hate you, exclude you, insult you, and reject you, your circumstances stink. Those are awful circumstances, and yet Jesus says you can rejoice, which is the verb form of the word joy. Joy and rejoice come from the same word. Rejoice is the verb, joy is the noun. Jesus says you can rejoice, you can leap for joy. Here's another one, 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 4. Paul says, in all our troubles, my joy knows no bounds. Okay, you would think that troubles would be the boundary line where joy stops and despair begins. But Paul said his joy leaped that boundary and kept going. His circumstances were awful. He had troubles, but he still had joy. One more, James chapter 1. This is crazy. James chapter 1. Consider it not just joy, pure joy. My brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. I got trials of many kinds. James says, pure joy, pure joy. And then as we noted in Philippians, Paul's in prison. The verdict is still out. He could get a death sentence if he's found guilty. He is writing to a group of people who, as we read through the book of Philippians, we find out they are divided among themselves. They're being confused by false teachers. They're living in a very hostile environment, and yet he repeatedly calls them to be joyful. Why is that? How is that? Let's look at Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. This is probably the least well-known part of this beautiful little letter, this little epistle that Paul sends. I have a sense, though, that it may be the most important part of this letter, which is why we're going to begin here instead of in chapter 1. Now, we're going to drill down a little deep here, okay? I want to make sure you're still with me. You good? Would you rather play another round of Would You Rather, or would you rather find out how to be joyful no matter what? Let's do that one. Okay, Philippians chapter 3, let's just look at the first three verses to start with, okay? Here we go. Further, my brothers and sisters, rejoice in the Lord. It is no trouble for me to write the same things to you again, and it is a safeguard for you. Watch out for those dogs, those evildoers, those mutilators of the flesh. This sounds kind of Halloween, doesn't it? Sounds a little bit like a Stephen King novel right there. For it is we who are the circumcision, we who serve God by His Spirit, who boast in Christ Jesus, and who put no confidence in the flesh. And the first thing I want us to notice is where joy is. I want us to notice where joy is located. Paul says, rejoice. Where is joy? In the Lord. It's in the Lord. We usually focus on the rejoice part, on the joy part, but as we're about to see in this passage, it's the in the Lord part that really matters. Paul's about to draw a very sharp distinction between people who rejoice in the Lord and people who rejoice in something else. Verse 2, he issues a very passionate warning. It's a vivid warning. The New International Version, unfortunately, smooths it out. Paul actually repeats the word watch out three times in that verse. If you get the English Standard Version, it shows up a lot more clearly here. But literally, here's how verse 2 reads in the original language. Watch out for those dogs. Watch out for those workers of evil. Watch out for those emasculators. You know how when you tell your child no once, it's not really a big no, just no. But if your child's about to run into the street on Memorial Parkway, it's no, 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 no. That's what Paul's doing here. It's no, 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 no. Just watch out, watch out, watch out. It's a big, big warning. And no, The warning about dogs is not a reference to a beloved but recently harmless SEC football team. It's an epithet. It's an insult. He's calling this group of people who have come to the city of Philippi and to the church there to teach something false, he's calling them dogs. But the biggest insult is in that phrase, mutilators of the flesh. Paul apparently coined that word himself. It doesn't show up anywhere else in Greek literature, so we think maybe Paul made this word up. The word for the Jewish rite of circumcision, the Greek word for the Jewish rite of circumcision is peritome. It literally means to cut around. That makes sense. The word Paul makes up and uses here is kata tome. It means to cut off. All the men in the room just shifted in their seats uncomfortably. Apparently, there were some people who had come to Philippi who were trying to convince the Christians that faith in Christ was not enough to save them, that they needed to jump through some extra hoops. One of those extra hoops being circumcision. These teachers were apparently bragging about how righteous they were, about how qualified their good living and all of the rituals that they performed were, and how deficient the Philippian Christians' faith was. And that's what Paul's addressing here. That's why he's angry. He says, they're dogs, they're mutilators of the flesh, don't listen to them. And then what he does next is really interesting, because he basically says in the next couple of verses, okay, you want to play that game? You want to play the game where you see who has done it better than somebody else, who's got the best spiritual resume? I'm going to take you to church and mama can't help you here. Look at verses 4, 5, and 6. If someone else thinks they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, in their ability to do it right, to satisfy the requirements of the law. If somebody else thinks that they've got reason to put confidence in that, I've got more. And so Paul begins to share his personal, spiritual, and religious resume. I was circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. In regard to the law, a Pharisee. As for zeal, persecuting the church. As for righteousness based on the law, faultless. Paul's going, so you guys are Hebrews, right? You false teachers that are here telling the Christians that believing in Jesus is not enough. So you're saying that you're Hebrews. Well, I'm a charter member. I'm from the tribe of Benjamin. Benjamin was the son of Rachel. That's the wife Jacob loved. Benjamin was the only one of the 12 patriarchs to be born in the land of promise. That gives Paul some clout, because if you were to ask people like Paul and these teachers that are throwing the church into confusion, if you were to say, would you rather meet your ancestors or would you rather meet your descendants, they'd say, I want to meet my ancestors, because that's what it's all about. Where I come from, the lineage, that's what it's all about. So Paul is saying, you want to go lineage? Here you go. I'm from the tribe of Benjamin. He was the favored son. Most famous person from the tribe of Benjamin was named Saul, Israel's first king. What was Paul's pre-Christian name? Saul. That's not an accident. He's saying, I got the credentials. I got the lineage. And then he says, I'm a Pharisee. The Pharisees were the Navy SEALs of Judaism. They were tough. What about zeal? Before I knew any better, I persecuted the church. Want to talk about going by the book? I was perfect. Paul's credentials are absolutely impeccable. So if you want to play that game where we're doing it better than anybody else, let's go, Paul's saying, because I've got you beat. But now look at what he does in verses 7, 8, and 9. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I lost all things. I consider them garbage. that I might gain Christ and be found in him. Listen to this. I think this is the most important part of the book. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, comes from me doing it right, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. Paul sounds like an accountant here, verses 7 and 8. He's talking about profit and loss. All the things I consider to be assets, I now consider to be liabilities. Once I underwent this internal audit from Jesus, I realized I was broke. What I thought was valuable was really worthless. What I thought was treasure really turns out to be trash. In fact, in verse 8, he uses the strongest word yet to describe how he feels about his impeccable credentials. The NIV translates it garbage. The Greek word is skubalon. It's a crude synonym for human waste. Imagine how that sounded read aloud in church on Sunday. So what's Paul saying? He's saying that salvation from sin is by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. He's saying that no matter how hard you try, no amount of conscientious living, are you listening, church, doctrine, or carefully observed rituals will qualify you for a relationship with God. The only thing that will qualify you for a relationship with God is the righteousness that comes from God through faith in Christ Jesus. That's it. Now, you may be a little bit confused right here. I thought we were talking about joy. We are. You remember how Paul began this section in chapter 3, verse 1? He began, the first thing he said in this chapter was, "Rejoice in the Lord." Because of what God did through Jesus on the cross, we can know joy, even in suffering. We can rejoice, even if our circumstances are mean. And the reason we can know joy, even if what is happening to us is awful, is because of where joy is. Paul says it three times in Philippians. It is in the Lord. Our joy is located not in what is happening to us, but in what has already happened for us. And I think this may be the answer to the question, there's so little joy in the world, because our joy is in the wrong place. Look, if your joy is located in the comforts of your life, your joy will vanish when life gets tough. And life always gets tough. If your joy is located in your power or position, it will vanish when your power fades or your position is replaced. And power always fades, and there's always somebody else to take a higher spot than you. If your joy is located in your youth or your vigor or your health, it will fade as you age. Have you ever noticed that some older folks seem to be so joyful while others seem to be just angry about getting old? Maybe it's because of where their joy is located. If your joy is located in your own ability to live a righteous life, to do it right, to believe it right, to practice it right. What's going to happen when you fail? And you will fail. We all fall short of the glory of God. Here's the thing I wonder. If our worship isn't full of the Spirit, if our worship is not full of the Spirit and truth, maybe it's because we are celebrating, rejoicing in the wrong thing. Is it possible that we sometimes, and Church of Christ especially, is it possible that we sometimes rejoice over how well we rejoice rather than over what God has done for us in Jesus? A moment ago we heard this passage in Romans chapter 5. Paul says that we boast or we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God in verse 2. In verse 11 he says that we boast
or we hope in our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained reconciliation. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus means that we are living in an eternal morning of God's grace and favor. And because of that, we can know joy no matter what. That's why all the songs we sang this morning were not about joy. They were about grace. That's why we can have joy. Here's how it works in every other religion. You live as you should, and God will accept you. That's how it is in every other religion. You live as you should, and God will accept you. In other words, you have to earn God's acceptance. Christianity is different. Christianity says you receive God's acceptance as a free gift based on Jesus' record, not your own. Then you can live as you should. Total reversal. That's the foundation and location of all our joy. In the coming weeks, we'll explore some of the ways of living that correlate with that gracious joy. But if you embrace that, if you embrace this idea that in our faith we receive God's acceptance as a free gift, and then we can live as we should, it will change everything. Let me leave you with an amazing truth, mind-blowing truth. This one will change your life too. We talk a lot about our joy and our rejoicing, and when we do it and how we do it. There's a verse in the Old Testament, though, that talks about God's joy and God's rejoicing. What does God rejoice over? Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. Listen to this. The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but the Lord will rejoice over you. You believe this? The Lord will rejoice over you with singing. That's good news. Let's stand. Let's sing about that.
The Lord our God is with you. He is mighty to save. The Lord will take great delight in you. He will quiet you.
Glad that you're. Let me point out just a couple of things as we close from your bulletin. The men's fishing trip, which is coming up in just a couple of weeks. This is the last day to sign up for that. You can see Robin Bridges right down here, second row. Also, there's a wedding shower next Sunday. Our annual day of prayer is coming up. And as Jody mentioned earlier, our TCM trunk or treat next Sunday night. Please be here with your car ready to go with a trunk. Also, this one update, Hoy Ledbetter is in room 796, and he can have visitors at this time now. So keep them in your prayers as well. We hope you have a great day, and Al will close in prayer. Let's
pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. Thank you for this time that we can come together and worship as a family, be invigorated and challenged through the worship activities that we thank you for the staff here at Twickenham and for everything that they do for us as a congregation. We pray that you be with us as we go out into the world today and throughout the rest of this week. Please help us to be examples and shining lights that are a representation of what you want us to be. Please guide guard everything that we do. And it's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen.